Welcome to Savvy IT Solutions. We are making a series of videos on technologies like programming in C, programming in Java, web technologies, etc., etc. Okay. Today we are making on programming in Java. So the first video on programming in Java is object-oriented programming concepts, also called as OOPS concepts. So now we are discussing about what is object-oriented programming, what is class, what is an object, what is encapsulation, what is abstraction, what is inheritance, what is polymorphism, what is dynamic binding, and what is message passing. So these are the 8 concepts available in object-oriented programming. Before that, we need to know what is object-oriented programming. So shall I start? Object-oriented programming is a new way of approaching the job of programming. Approaches to programming have changed dramatically since the invention of the computer in order to accommodate the increasing complexity of programs. Object-oriented programming takes the best ideas of structured programming and combines them with powerful new concepts that encourage you to look at the task of programming in a new light. Object-oriented programming allows you to easily decompose a problem into subgroups of related parts. Then you can translate these subgroups into self-contained units called objects. All object-oriented programming languages have 3 things in common. These are objects, inheritance, and polymorphism. More about object-oriented programming. It is a methodology, not a technology. It means that methodology means framing the rules but not at all implemented. Technology implements the methodology to get the better results. Okay, so object-oriented programming is the highest methodology in programming languages. Which programming language uses object-oriented programming? C++, Java, .NET, PHP, Python, Kotlin, etc., etc. So now we need to know the 8 concepts of object-oriented programming. Under this, the first one is the class. Classes are user-defined data types and behave like the built-in data types of a programming language. The entire set of data and code of an object can be made a user-defined data type with the help of a class. In fact, objects are variables of the type class. Each object is associated with the data of type class with which they are created. A class is a collection of objects of similar type. For example, mango, apple, and orange are the members of the class fruit. So fruit is a class and mango is an object. So simply we can say that the class is a collection of variables and functions, where variables are called data members and functions are called member functions of a class. Now we are looking to the second concept called object. Objects are the basic runtime entities in an object-oriented system. They may represent a person, a place, a bank account, a table of data, or any item that the program has to be handled. Objects take up space in the memory and have an associated address like a record in Pascal or a structure in C. Objects are nothing but variables of type classes, or objects are nothing but instances of a class. Difference between class and object. Class is nothing but gives an example of construction of a house. First we need to make a blueprint for the building plan for that house. So that building plan is nothing but a class, and after constructing the house and using it is called an object. So whenever we are creating a class, the memory will not be allocated. Whenever we are creating an object for the class, the memory will be allocated and use it. Now we are moving into the third concept called data encapsulation. The wrapping up of data and functions into a single unit is known as encapsulation. This is similar to the definition of class. But the difference between data encapsulation and the class is, class, you know everything, what is the functionality internally, how it works. But in data encapsulation, we don't know internally how it works, but how we need to use it should be known very clearly. So let us take a simple example. If you are using a TV with a, we are operating a TV with a remote. When we start the button, the TV will start, and when we stop, click on stop button, automatically the TV will be closed. Similarly, whenever we are changing the channels, automatically the channels will be changed, and we need to increase the volume as well as the decrease the volume. But we don't know internally how it works, but physically we know that how we need to operate. So the next concept is data abstraction. Abstraction refers to the act of representing essential features without including background details or explanations. Classes use the concept of abstraction and are defined as a list of attributes and functions to operate on these attributes. They encapsulate all the essential properties of the objects that are to be created. Simply, we can say that abstraction means hiding the information. How we need to hide the information? Using three keywords. One is public, second one is private, third one is protected. Public means we can access anywhere in the project. Private means only within the class we can access it. Protected means whenever the inheritance exists, the protected members of the base class are converted into private members of the derived class, and furtherly we cannot derive. So the next concept is inheritance. Inheritance is the process by which objects of one class acquire the properties of objects of another class. It is also called as the mechanism of deriving a new class from already existing class. It supports the concept of hierarchical classification. For example, the bird robin is a part of the class flying bird, which is again a part of the class bird. The idea behind this sort of division is that each derived class shares common characteristics with the class from which it is derived. Inheritance provides the idea of reusability. It is also can be defined, whenever a software is developing, the first version is the basic version or beta version. After they are updating with new features, then already existing features with additionally they are providing new features. Whenever we are updating the application, automatically the new features are enhanced and already existing features are available with them. That is the concept of inheritance. So it helps to reduce the code reusability. Now, types of inheritances. They are classified into 5 types of inheritances: single inheritance, multiple inheritance, multi-level inheritance, hierarchical inheritance, and hybrid inheritance. Single inheritance. Single inheritance means only one derived class derived from only one base class is called single inheritance. So the first class is called base class or parent class or super class. This B is called derived class or child class or subclass. So only one derived class derived from only one base class is called single inheritance. Okay, the second one is multiple inheritance. It means that only one derived class derived from more than one base class is called multiple inheritance. But Java does not support multiple inheritance. The next one is multi-level inheritance. Derived class derived from Already existing derived class is called multiple inheritance. So C is derived from B, B is already derived from A. This is called multi-level inheritance. The next one is hierarchical inheritance. This is maintaining a hierarchy. More than one derived class derived from only one base class is called hierarchical inheritance. So finally, hybrid inheritance. Any two combinations of inheritance edges, then it is called hybrid inheritance. This is hierarchical inheritance. Here single inheritance, this is multiple inheritance. So it is hybrid inheritance. So the next concept is polymorphism. Polymorphism, a Greek term, means the ability to take more than one form. Means poly means many and morphism means forms. The ability to take more than one form is called polymorphism. Polymorphism is classified into two types. One is compile time polymorphism. Second one is run time polymorphism. Again, this compile time polymorphism is classified into two more types. One is operator overloading. Second one is function overloading. This runtime polymorphism is classified into two more categories, virtual functions and pure virtual functions. So, operator overloading means the process of making an operator to exhibit different behaviors in different instances is known as operator overloading. Example of asterisk, when we are multiplying with two numbers, then the multiplication symbol. It is also work like a pointer variable. So, two different behaviors of an operator. The second one, but Java does not support operator overloading. Function overloading, using a single function name to perform different types of tasks is known as function overloading. So the example, same method name is sum, adding two or passing two arguments and means adding with two numbers. Similarly, I am also using now we are passing three arguments. The behavior changes but the function names are same. That is called function overloading. Java supports function overloading. Virtual functions means I am explaining you that Java does not support multiple inheritance. So why? Because if you take, this is the concept of multiple inheritance. This class having the method assign, this class also having the method name is assign. When I am calling assign method in the derived class, we don't know exactly which class assign method will be executed first. To solve this problem by using which method will be accessed first, we need to put virtual keyword before that. Automatically the method will be accessed simultaneously, the second method will be accessed. So on that purpose the virtual function will be used. Similarly, if the method having no body, then it is called pure virtual function. So these two also not supported in Java. The next one is dynamic binding. Binding refers to the linking of a procedure call to the code to be executed in response to the call. It is very simple that how a class and objects are communicating. Dynamic binding, also known as late binding, means that The code associated with a given procedure call is not known until the time of the call at runtime. It is associated with polymorphism and inheritance. Finally, the last concept of object-oriented programming is called message passing. An object-oriented program consists of a set of objects that communicate with each other. A message for an object is a request for execution of a procedure and therefore will invoke a function in the receiving object that generates the desired result. It involves specifying the name of the object, the name of the function, and the information to be sent. For example, employee is an object, salary is a message, and name is an information passed to that. So dynamic binding and message passing are almost all grouped together. How a class and object is communicating in between. Thank you.